Now the broader effects. I often get accused of concentrating on a single issue, missing the bigger picture. I'm sure you hear the same thing sometimes. It's not true. The wider effects of prohibition are so far-reaching, and they're so bad, that prohibition is more than a single issue. And there may not be a bigger issue than this one. There may not be. There's at least five broader effects that I can find. One, prohibition just hoovers up all of our tax money. It vacuums up that money. It takes it away so it cannot be used for education, cannot be used for health care, cannot be used for environmental improvement, because it's all devoted to prohibition. The U.S. has spent $1 trillion in the last 40 years on prohibition. $1 trillion. That's a big number, but I want to try and give you an idea of just how big that is. It's hard to visualize. But we can do it a little bit, thanks to some of our members. Jack Cole, former executive director of Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, has a very nice little photograph. It shows a room. The room is about half the size of the stage. On the floor of the room, it stacked up 3 feet high and covering the entire floor of that room, half the size of the stage, are stacks of $100 bills. So imagine a room half the size of that stage piled 3 feet high with $100 bills. That is only $225 million. The amount the U.S. has spent on the drug war in the past 40 years is equal to 4,000 rooms that big. Think of what effective programs a government could do with 4,000 rooms that big, full of $100 bills stacked 3 feet high. That's what prohibition has taken away from what could have been done. Now in Canada, the 1/10 rule will be 100 billion. We have not spent 100 billion yet on prohibition, but Harper's working on it. Next broader effect of prohibition. So there's a waste of money. The next broader effect is Roma talked about evidence-based policy. And this is fundamental to public policy economics. The way you make a decision about what to do with your taxpayers' money, if you're a government, is to use the money in ways that have benefits. You need evidence of benefits to justify using the money for anything. Any government that can put its money into prohibition is completely ignoring this. So there's a bigger issue. If a government is putting its money into prohibition, that government is showing we don't understand or don't even care whether we get a benefit or not from spending your money and my money. That's not tolerable. It's not the way you do government policy. Third broader effect of prohibition. Cripples the economy because most drug users, and especially marijuana users, if they can get their drugs, the amounts they need, they can hold down a job, lead a family, do all the things that anyone who's not a drug user can do. They can. And most of them do. You realize there are 5 million at least adult marijuana users in Canada, and the vast majority of them are holding down jobs, living a life just like anyone who isn't using marijuana. What happens to the economy if they get arrested? They're no longer a productive member of the economy, they're now in prison, and they are a drag on the economy. In the U.S., they arrest 850,000 people every year for simple possession. Now, how many people that is? That is the entire population of New Brunswick. Everybody, every man, woman, child, and baby in New Brunswick. They arrest that many people every year for simple possession in the U.S. We're not arresting people at that rate yet. Harper is working on it. Next thing, the fourth thing that prohibition does, it destroys the principles of justice, human rights, and the rule of law. I'm not making this up. I am not making this up. It sounds extreme, but it is the truth. In the U.S., Search and seizure without cause has become routine. Home invasions by SWAT teams using machine guns, full battle gear, grenades, sometimes at the wrong house, are routine. Many times every day. In many of those raids, somebody gets killed. A police officer, the homeowner, somebody gets killed. Confiscation of assets without conviction, sometimes without even somebody being charged in the U.S., is routine. Property rights in the U.S. If there's any place in the world where you would think property rights were sacred, it should be the U.S. Well, they're not. All that's routine. We're not there in Canada yet, but Harper's working on it. Finally, this is a bit subtle. Keeping up prohibition requires the politics of hate. Now, this point, I give credit not to the elite members I work with, but to Peter Ferenczi, who was here speaking on a talk organized by Gabor Maté. Peter Ferenczi, who calls himself PhD and crackhead. And the reason why prohibition requires the politics of hate is that in order to justify what we do under prohibition to drug users and to low-level drug users, we pretty well have to convince ourselves that they deserve it. We pretty well have to convince ourselves that they are some kind of subhuman and that it's okay to treat them in ways that you probably wouldn't treat your dog. If you don't, it's almost impossible to justify what we do under prohibition unless you take that out. And there is the danger, because that attitude that any group of people deserves abuse, you don't have to go very far in 20th century history to see where that takes you. So all of this, I think, helps you understand why Jim Gierach is a LEAP speaker, prosecutor, former prosecutor, now an attorney in Chicago. He describes it this way. The war on drugs is basically the heart of nearly any crisis you can name in America. The problems with guns, gangs, crime, prisons, taxes, deficits, AIDS, health care, trade imbalance, corruption of the police, of kids, no money for schools and constructive things like drug treatment, job stimulus, and of course, we fund terrorism. I now understand why Jim says that. Finally, the effects on law enforcement. So we talked about the direct effects of prohibition, the broader effects, and now the effects on law enforcement. This is where it really is instructive to listen to LEAP members. I spent a lot of time listening to the tapes and watching the audio tapes and getting these words down exactly, because they're very important. The first impact of law enforcement is corruption. Here's what Jerry Cameron says. We don't learn a thing from history. We want our institutions to be pure and not corrupt. But yet we do the things that we know are going to corrupt them. We know that prohibition will corrupt law enforcement because that's what it did in the 1920s. And that's what it does again. Bill Vandergraff, retired Winnipeg police sergeant and LEAP speaker, he says, vice cops are almost always corrupt. And that doesn't mean that vice cops are by nature rotten people. What it means above all is that if you are in that business of a vice cop, enforcing prohibition, enforcing the prohibition on prostitution, for instance, you are in a position where corruption is rewarded and honesty is punished. It's in the system. Peter Crist, retired police captain from Buffalo, New York. Here's what he says. Now you came into this thing, meaning law enforcement, now you came into this thing a bright-eyed, shiny young recruit. You're a police officer 4 or 5 years. You've seen the wasted energy that you spent on this drug war. And now you're standing in a motel room where the drug arrests have just been made. Laying on the bed is $100 and some thousand dollars that hasn't been counted yet in cash. and in your back pocket is a $3,800 bill from the plumber that you didn't know how you were going to pay. And it doesn't make any difference anyway. There's how corruption starts, caused by prohibition. Second thing, second effect of law enforcement, prohibition forces you as law enforcers into working on the wrong things. Here's Stephen Downing, retired deputy police chief of Los Angeles. You have things like grants, you have things like asset seizures that are used as tools by the federal government to buy off local law enforcement. One tiny example. When the four attorney generals in California decided to attack our medical marijuana dispensaries, they sent ahead $72 million to local law enforcement. That $72 million took our police officers, who were supposed to be out investigating crimes against persons, rapes, robberies, burglaries, thefts of cars, and things like that. Those dollars turn our peace officers into drug warriors. And that $72 million is just an example. I often wonder, and I don't think this is going to come out in the inquiry, but I really often wonder, if the RCMP and the Vancouver Police Department hadn't been obligated to spend so much time on drug enforcement, how much sooner might Robert Picton have been caught? I don't know the answer. I don't like the fact that we even have the question.